Thank you. Hello, welcome everyone to EuroPython. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, where from which time zone, whichever time zone you are in. So this talk, as evident from the title, it's going to be around managing complex applications on Kubernetes while staying in Python ecosystem. So Kubernetes is mostly written in Golang, and it has the most active community in Golang. But I wanted to introduce some of the frameworks and tools and software patterns that we can actually code using Python while staying in Python ecosystem. We can automate all of that stuff. So for this particular talk, if you have some basic understanding of Kubernetes concepts like pods, deployments, or services, it'll be best. You'll be able to get the most out of this talk if you have knowledge around some of the basic Kubernetes concepts. A little bit about myself. I'm Gautam, and I'm a software engineer from Grofers India, one of the largest online grocery shopping platform in the country. We run a fleet of more than 20 microservices on a Kubernetes cluster, which like on the extreme zone, we go up to a million daily active users on those microservices. They are written in Python, Flask, Django. And I completed my bachelor's in software engineering from Delhi Technological University. I graduated back in 2018. I did GSOC with LibreOffice. I love open source. I have contributed to Mozilla, Firefox for Android, OpenMR, medical record systems, Foss Asia, Open Event Projects, and others in the past. And as Sangarshan said, this is going to be my first talk in any conference for that matter. So please bear with me. Okay, so I've divided this talk into four phases. For phase one, we are going to talk about introductions. We're going to introduce and discuss some problem scenarios that come from running applications on Kubernetes. We're going to discuss problems with configuration management, setting up a database cluster, and then we are going to introduce a focus problem for this talk, which is around running a Silvery cluster on production. And so since Silvery is a very popular distributed task queue system written in Python, I chose it for this talk. And in phase two, we are going to generalize the learnings, all the manual steps that we do, what all the different pain points are of managing stateful in general in Kubernetes. And we are going to discuss the goal for the Silvery automation that we are going to do. We are going to solve each of the manual steps incrementally. And then we are going to discuss the extension capabilities in Kubernetes that are going to help us achieve that automation. In the phase three, we are going to build that solution incrementally. And at each step, whatever manual steps we discuss, we're going to automate them and we are going to see them in action. We're going to see the custom Silvery resource, and then we'll see the operator. Operator is something that I'll discuss later in the talk, reacting to the events. We'll also see the auto scaling and downscaling of Silvery workers based on queue depth. That is not really provided out of the box by Kubernetes. And in the phase four, we'll conclude. We're going to see what is world doing with operators, what are existing frameworks, SDKs, and other use cases, and then we'll proceed to Q&A. Okay, let's start with the first problem. These are some real world scenarios. I'm going to discuss three real world scenarios as part of problems, or rather call them opportunities where we can automate stuff. So this is a very common problem with configuration management in Kubernetes. Kubernetes provides config map and secrets object to actually manage your configuration on a cluster. And there is a very common problem with that, that whenever you need to change a value in config map, you need to go and restart the corresponding deployment whenever that value is modified. So this is a very burning issue. You can see from the number of reactions on this issue, which has in Kubernetes open source project. And one way of solving this would be to imagine like there is a watcher pod that was managing those config maps and deployment objects. And as soon as that you change the config map values, it automatically triggered the relevant deployment. This is one of the opportunities that has a potential of automation. And coming up to a slightly complex example, this is when you set up a database cluster, anything, Postgres, Redis, or MongoDB, you Running a database is actually easy. You just need to write a deployment spec, the declarative spec that you're going to provide. You are going to define a persistent volume. Then you're going to claim that volume into the deployment. This running is as simple as that. However, managing that cluster over the time is difficult. It's you need to set up connection pooling. You need to manage resize or upgrades in case space runs out or you're running on a lower version. And you need to take care of reconfiguration, which requires operational expertise. Like if I'm working with Postgres, I need to know its internals. There is a 3DS generation templating and so on. These are some of the various problems like backups and recovery as well, which need an infrastructure operator to actually do all these things manually. Now coming to something that is very popular in Python ecosystem called Celery, which is also going to be the focus of this talk. So let's start with the basics. What is Celery? Celery is a popular distributed task queue system. And I work for an e-commerce company. So there, the typical use cases that we use Celery for are asynchronous workloads, like sending emails, SMSs, or doing anything that is post order has been placed, triggering cashbacks or promotions or rewards to the users based on the order status changes. So this is what we use Celery from. And if you see on the bottom left, you see a very basic Celery Flask application architecture that there is a Flask application that pushes messages to a broker, which could be Redis or RabbitMQ or any other broker. And then Celery workers, which are running, they pick tasks from that broker and process them and sends the result back to the broker or wherever you have configured. And this is what a very simple Flask Celery application looks like. You define a Flask application, you define the broker URL, which is Redis master in this case. You just define the result backend. And there is a very simple task that is defined, which simply adds the two numbers and returns the result back. So this is going to happen asynchronously later on. So, and this is the command that needs to be run to start a Celery worker. You need to provide the path to your Celery application. You need to pass the worker argument, and then you have tons of configuration options, concurrency, logging level, and all those things that are provided by Celery. So this example that we saw was a very basic Flask Celery application that you can set up on your local and try it out. Now, when you have to do this on production, when you have to deploy this Flask Celery example on production, you need to, on Kubernetes specifically, then you need to have a worker deployment YAML that looks somewhat like this. The kind of deployment, how many number of replicas you want, how many number of workers you want, and then you specify the containers like Celery or your container name Celery, which is and the image which you're going to pull, and the command that is going to be running inside the containers, and then there are different arguments like queues, queue name, log level, concurrency, and all those things, resource constraints that you can specify. So this is one manual step that you need to write a worker deployment YAML. Then when you're running on production, you need to set up monitoring as well. You need to make sure that your Celery workers are running all the time and your broker is healthy, your messages are being processed or not. And de facto standard for that is Flower, whatever you like to pronounce it with. So de facto standard to monitor Celery is Flower. And then you need to also write a Flower deployment spec, and you need to expose that deployment as a service so that people who are outside the cluster can access and actually see whether your cluster is working fine or not. And then you have to also manage auto scaling. When you're running on production, you never know that when there is going to be a high workload or low workload. So you need to set up some kind of auto scaling in place where you actually want to might want to scale the workers on resource constraint, like if my Celery or if my CPU or memory has increased beyond a certain limit, then you need to scale it. Or a very specific thing to Celery that if number of messages in your Redis queue are more or are increasing, you can simply scale the number of workers to maintain an average value, which is going to be processed by each worker. But this is not really supported in Kubernetes directly. And summarizing these problems, like of running a celery cluster on production, what all you need to do, there is a block diagram on the right. So there is this worker deployment, which we discussed, which is going to manage the celery worker pods. There is flower deployment, which is going to manage flower pods. There is flower service, which is going to send the request traffic to flower pods and show the results back to the user. And then there's the Flask Celery simple example that we saw. Flask application is going to push messages to the broker, and Celery worker pods will pick the messages and keep processing them. This is a typical Celery cluster in production. Now, coming to the problems when you are going to manage this cluster on production. It's not easy to get a new setup right. We saw all the manual steps that we needed to take a look. And there is no way to actually set up multiple clusters in a consistent way, because if you're working in a different team, when you have more than 100 engineers who are using Celery for the different use cases, there is no way to set up any cluster in a consistent way. Everyone is configuring their own way. There are a lot of possibilities of misconfiguration, because Celery and Flower, they both provide tons of configuration options. You might misconfigure concurrency control or logging level or anything that can go wrong will go wrong in production. And later on, it also creates problems with infrastructure audit. If you're multiple, nobody knows that how many resources are being used by this cluster, whether it actually requires it or not. So all these things are problems when it comes to running Celery on production. Generalizing these learnings, these problems or opportunities, we can simply say that managing stateless on Kubernetes is easy, but stateful applications like databases, caching systems, message queuing systems, they need specific domain logic of how they are to be set up on a production and the scaled, upgraded, or recovered in case any disaster happens on production for a typical business use case. And Kubernetes is designed for automation. It is possible to extend its behavior to manage all these complex applications while staying in Python ecosystem. And also there is one more problem, that you need to bridge the gap between application engineers and infrastructure operators who actually manage these services. And next we are going to discuss the goals for this problem. As mentioned here, deploying and managing stateful software like Celery, it should be made easy for everyone. And Kubernetes has led to a wider adoption because of its declarative way of specifying the configuration. And if I could specify my Celery deployment, something like this, there's this kind Celery, and there's this common spec where I can provide my app name, my path to Celery app, and then the image that I'm going to run, and then the worker spec, the number of workers, and I've limited it to very simple configuration options, right, which Celery provides right now. And similarly, there is Flower spec and resource constraints and all these things that you can configure. If I, as an application developer, would be able to specify a YAML like this, and I do nothing more than a kubectl apply my spec.yaml, it should be able to set up all the worker deployments, their monitoring, their scaling automatically in the best way possible. This is the goal for this talk, that this is what we are going to achieve in the end. Kubernetes should be able to understand this spec and take actions accordingly on the different events that are going to happen. So as I discussed, there is this kind Celery which is specified here. Now, Kubernetes does not know out of the box what is Celery or what is your Postgres, any other database. It knows what is a deployment, it knows what is a pod, it knows what is a service, right? So it is possible to extend that behavior using a concept called CRD, custom resource definitions. I can define my custom resource in Kubernetes, and I can extend Kubernetes APIs to actually understand that custom resource named Celery. So it also let you provide a structured schema, what all worker spec, flower spec that we saw. It lets you define the structure schema of that custom object. And that helps in standardizing the specification across the Kubernetes cluster that you are running for the multiple Celery applications. So this is the block diagram that we saw. There was this native KX object, there was worker deployment, flower deployment service that we saw earlier in the talk. And then there is the CRD which I'm going to define the CRD and then custom resource, and then the resource that salary resource which we saw will have some sort of status, and it is going to pass through some sort of logic that we are going to discuss next. But this should be able to, the Kubernetes should be able to understand all this. That's the whole aim. So how will this custom resource definition for salary look like? This custom resource definition will look somewhat like this. I define a custom resource definition. I type the metadata, I type the client salary and the short names, and I specify an OpenAPI v3 schema for this object. I'm going to show you this in full. Like, how does this? Just a second. Okay, so this is what my custom resource definition for salary looks like. This is a very proof of concept version right now. It's not a fully fledged production version to make the talk simple. And this is the spec that I'm expecting. This is the common spec, the common configuration parameters that I can pass in. Then there's this worker spec, which can accept all these number of properties, like number of workers you want, queues, log level, concurrency. And then there's flash spec, and towards the end, we have the auto scaling targets as well. So this is how this custom salary resource will look like. And with the help of this, Kubernetes cluster will be able to understand my custom resource of salary that looks like this, kind salary and the common parameter worker spec, flash spec, and all the scaling targets that I've specified. Okay, so simple way of creating this custom resource definition that is defined is using a kubectl apply deploy /crd.yaml. If you get the CRDs, you'll see that salary is created, salary project, salary CRD is created. And when I create my custom resource, which is deploy/cr.yaml, I can also get the salary applications that are running currently on my cluster. Now, if you see that right now, nothing will happen. Kubernetes is just able to recognize that there is some salary resource that has come in and I have to accept it and I have to store it in the database. That's it. Now, coming to something that is going to react, that is going to make all those automation happen. Now we are going to talk about controllers. Controllers in Kubernetes are at the core of its self-healing capabilities, and they continuously execute control loops for all the API objects they are watching. On the side, right side, there is a very simple example of a replica set controller. So you specified that I need number of pods that are equal to 3. Then this replica set controller constantly runs a control loop that is going to make sure that this number is always there in the system. It continuously checks the observed state. It takes the decision like whether number of pods is more than 3 or less than 3. It'll create more pods or delete extra pods accordingly. And it'll eventually make sure that your desired state is reached. Now, Kubernetes also provides flexibility to write custom controllers to manage your custom resources. Our custom resources that I created was salary, and I can write a custom controller that is going to be watching my salary resource and take appropriate actions. So coming to this reconciliation loop, so Kubernetes works on this concept of level triggered versus edge triggered some of you might have studied in electronics. So this level, what happens in level triggered is that when a signal goes from 0 to 1, there is a loop that continuously executes on that level until that signal comes down to 0. And similarly in the edge triggered concept, what happens, when the state changes from 0 to 1, then only your code, your thing will be executed. But in level triggered, it continuously makes sure that your signal should go to 0 or your signal should go from 0 to 1 while it is there. So Okay, coming to the next part, when you combine CRDs with custom controllers that you are going to define, you build this thing called operator pattern. Operator pattern is a way of managing, it's a software pattern, design pattern, which lets you actually manage complex applications in Kubernetes. It'll take care of creating, scaling, upgrades, recovery, and more. And later in this talk, we are going to actually code that controller, which custom controller, which we saw. And operators are simply these software that actually extend the native Kubernetes abilities to reliably manage all these complex applications. It was it was introduced by CoreOS, which is now acquired by Red Hat. You can simply call them a Kubernetes native app, similar to what you have for Android apps, or Android exposes the APIs on which you can build apps. Similarly, Kubernetes exposes APIs to build apps for itself, and operator pattern is one of the design patterns you can follow to actually build a Kubernetes native app. Again, all operators are controllers, but not every controller is an operator. This is a very important distinction, that controller is what we saw earlier. It could be a very generic one that just runs a reconciliation loop, like replica set controller, deployment control. But operators are actually custom controllers that have the operational knowledge baked in their code. Now, coming to the implementation, operators can be written in any language runtime, which can actually interact with Kubernetes API. And this talk specifically encourages writing operators and supporting frameworks in Python ecosystem. Right now, Golang is a popular choice because the whole Kubernetes is written in Golang. So this talk is about how what all things you can achieve while staying in the Python ecosystem with Kubernetes. And there are a lot of examples that the existing operators that are out there, like Prometheus operator is there, etcd operator is there, MongoDB operator is there. It's as simple as installing these operators, and they're going to take care of managing the whole cluster for you. Right, coming to the controller part, that now we are going to control, now we are going to implement our custom controller for Celery. So let's start with creation. Okay, so whenever I created my new Celery resource, there should be something that is going to react and bring the all the worker deployments, Flower deployments, and Flower service, that all the manual steps that we did for running a fast Celery on production. So I have used a popular framework called KOPF, Kubernetes Operator Pythonic Framework. It's open sourced by Zalando SE. It's a German-based e-commerce company. So the general idea of that framework is that it takes care of interacting with the Kubernetes API automatically, and it exposes the handlers that you can code. So you just need that domain expertise to code in Python, and everything else will be taken care of by the, you don't need to know the Kubernetes internals to actually write a controller. So this is a simple watch that I'm doing on my Celery resource. I create this handler is going to be fired when I'm actually creating my Celery resource. And then number one, it's going to validate the spec. If the incoming spec that you have specified is valid or not, and then it instantiates the Kubernetes APIs, and it deploys the workers, Flower, and services. I'm not going to, these are simple utility functions that just hit the Kubernetes API using a YAML, and just return the updated number of children, that all the children that it has created, they're going to go in this response of this create function. So if you can see in the block diagram, this creation handler is watching the custom resource, and it sends back the status as all the children that it has created back to resource status. Now, I've talked enough. Let's see something in action. So I've made a demo video. Right. So this, first of all, we're going to see the CRD and CR creation. I talked about how you create a CRD, and this CRD.yaml we see now, now our Kubernetes cluster will be able to recognize the CLV resources I created. I'm now going to create my custom CLV resource as well. So I recorded a video. I wanted to do this live, but like my system is kind of low on RAM when you're doing a video sharing and all those things. So, okay, now I did that. I created the custom resource. Now I'm going to deploy my handler or my operator. Just a second. Now, as soon as you see on the right, I have created a watch on the pods. As soon as the operator comes in, it's going to identify that I created a custom celery resource, and it's going to identify that I created it, and it's going to execute all those things, and it's going to create deployment for celery workers and flower service and all those things automatically. Now we're going to see if our cluster is in healthy state by checking the floor. So this is my service that is created, Flower. Okay, yeah, so this is the Flower UI I have two celery workers that are currently online. I have not started pushing in tasks yet. I can simply monitor the application like this. Okay, so this is what we saw, the creation handler in action right now. And similarly, if I do, I'm gonna check the status of creation handler that is going to be stored in this custom object that I created. And if you see this creation function is, that's the problem with video. You cannot go along with what you're saying. So this is the creation function. It's going to store all the children it created, deployment, how many number of replicas it did, services, and the configuration for that service. Okay. So moving back to the PPT, now what we saw was the creation handler. Now we might want to edit our cluster configuration in production when it's running on production. So you need some sort of updation capabilities as well. So for the updation, there is this update function that now I just got the diff from what all things that I updated. I'm gonna know that what all different spec that was updated. If I modified the common spec, then I need to update all the deployments for the Kubernetes for the celery cluster. And if I just modified the worker spec, I need to modify the worker deployments similarly for the Flower. And the updation handler, again, it's going to return the result back to the resource status, which we saw. Okay, so let's see the same in action. I'm gonna edit my celery resource. So I'm just gonna leave the custom spec as it is. I'm gonna make my Flower replicas to two. I'm gonna change my worker spec to, let's say, I want my concurrency back to one and log level to info, number of workers to be four instead of two. And you can see the current state of the cluster, all the pods that are running in the cluster. And as soon as I edited, my handler invoked the updation handler, and it created more workers for me. So this is eventually going to reach that state of 4 workers. Right now the deployment strategy is set as rolling update, so it's going to do that rolling update with the max search possible. Okay, perfect. So now moving on to the auto scaling part, which is the coolest part of this having this operator. So how do you actually handle that? You need to auto scale your worker based on queue length. So there is a handler that there is a timer that runs every X seconds, and it actually hits the Flyer service to know what is the current status and what is the current queue length in the broker, and it publishes back to that status. Okay. So this is as simple as just publishing the message queue length that is from taking in from the Flyer service to the resource status. And coming to the auto scaling part, there is a watcher that there is a handler that is watching the published queue length, and as soon as that is changed, it is triggered. So it actually takes in the what is the number of current replicas, what all the scaling targets are, and what are the number of replicas, max replicas, and it's through a simple algorithm, it's going to make sure that updated number of replicas are equal to the average number, and it's going to patch that worker deployment to actually make that happen. So this is the block diagram. Simply just watches the queue, it triggers scaling of the worker deployments based on whatever queue length it is getting. So now if you see, right now, auto scale handler demo. Okay, so if you see on the bottom, you see this, there's a message queue length or timer that is being invoked every 10 seconds. And it's right now, I'm not pushing any queue, anything that in the British broker. And I created a Flask example that is going to bombard or Redis queue with number of tasks. And now the changes will start to happen. And as soon as the status changes, like the number of messages increased, the auto scale handler was triggered and it increased the number of workers to handle that increased load. As you can see, it updated the number of replicas to 5, which was our limit, as we are currently bombarding the task queue. And you can see that there are, all the workers are online and they're processing continuously. And now I'm going to delete my Flask application to see that whether the downscaling is going to happen as the number of messages is going down. So let's wait for a bit so that all these salary messages which are being processed, they go down in number. All right, yeah, so the changes have started happening. As soon as the application went down, which is pushing, it's going to terminate all the extra pods and take care of managing this whole cluster automatically. So you can see that this is really cool stuff, right? I just needed to deploy that operator YAML once, and I just needed to specify my custom resource as a declarative spec, and that is it. And it is going to take care of setting up to updation to actually scaling the resource automatically. Okay, so coming to the like merging all those diagrams that we saw previously during the talk, we started from here with a very basic Flask salary example. As Redis master is there, it's going to the queue is being consumed by salary worker pods. And then there's a creation handler that we saw. It's going to create all these nodes. Updation handler is going to update all these deployments. And similarly, this is a flowchart of the whole operator that I built for this talk. It's a proof of concept stage. It has still has a way to go for production. But yeah, this is something interesting that I wanted to share with the community. So we're moving towards the end of the talk. What all things we talked about? We saw the problems and opportunities from running stateful application on Kubernetes. We saw the manual steps, what are steps that we need to do to actually launch Celery on a production Kubernetes cluster. And then we saw the goals, what should have, what I want to have as an application developer or an infrastructure engineer. And then we discussed the extension capabilities, controllers, and operator pattern and CRD. And we saw the creation, updation, and auto-scaling implementation in action. Okay, so next steps for this project. This was I wanted to learn about operators in general, so I created this project. And this is live and open source on my GitHub. And there is still some way to go for making it production ready. If you're running Celery on production, if you're running Kubernetes on production, you're more than welcome to actually tell me about what I'll suggest, what all we can improve on this operator. And I'm going to be committing certain hour numbers weekly based on the feedback that I get from this conference and the other ones. And North Star aim for this operator could be to actually include it with the Celery 5 release milestone. I'm yet to discuss it with the Celery maintainers. And there is an ongoing discussion on Celery enhancement proposals repo around the same that they wish to have a Helm chart or an operator for Celery. So this is going to be exciting. Okay, so what are different people doing with operators? It's a relatively new concept. It was introduced back in 2016 itself. There is a repository called Awesome Operators. You can see all the awesome operators that people have built using Golang, Python, and all the other languages. There is a registry of operators as well. Like this operatorhub.io, there are different operators for all these applications that are very famous and used in production clusters, Prometheus, Airflow, Couchbase, MongoDB, Console, and all these applications. And there's a idea that I wanted to share, like when you are actually running a fleet of more than 100, 200 microservices, when you're running at a scale of, let's say, companies like Pinterest, Instagram, there could be an operator that lets you set up a new microservice and it'll inject these standard pieces like containers, volumes, logging, monitoring, and create a Grafana dashboard automatically for you, which are rather manual tasks where an infrastructure engineer is usually involved. And there are different frameworks and resources to build operators that I discussed about Kubernetes, like KOPF, which is open source by Zalando SE, which is a Python framework. There's Operator SDK, which is in Golang. Similarly, Golang has multiple resources. It was officially launched for Golang. And then there is this Meta Controller, which is a Kubernetes plugin that makes it easier to write custom controllers in every language. And as I said before, this talk is going to my aim for this talk was to actually introduce operator pattern to Python community and what all we can do to actually make this community more mature, to build the Kubernetes native apps. All right, I have spoken enough. So,
okay, awesome. It's time for Q&A. Okay, so here's the first question. Do you have any front end to see the task processed across the scaling activity?
Task process to see the I haven't worked with Minikube dashboard, but I'm sure that Minikube dashboard must be providing this thing. So I'm gonna I don't have it right now, but showed you that is it, and I'm gonna try it out, and we can take this discussion back to the our breakout room.
Okay, so an anonymous attendee would want you to share your slides and the example code that you shared in GitHub.
Yeah, I have. I think I have shared the link to repository. It's on my. I'm going to post it in my breakout room. So you're more than welcome to just take a look at the code. It's not really production ready, so please bear with that. And like, there's still some way to go, and I'll be working actively to actually improve it.
Okay, so here's the third question. Is there any problems with failed tasks during downscaling?
With failed tasks? No, so I think this downscaling is automatic. So deployment as a whole actually manages automatically. Like all the tasks, the salary workers are only going to pick the tasks when they are ready. And when they are killed, immediately they stop the tasks. And in this case, I think it was fine. Like we saw the Flutter monitoring that none of the tasks actually failed, or none of the workers were actually killed while they were processing the task. So I think Celery and Flutter, Celery, it automatically takes care of that. Whenever the worker is killed, it's not killed amidst running a message when it's processing a message.
Okay, awesome. So actually, I have a question. So could you maybe tell us the difference between having a Helm chart and having a custom operator for the same use case? Why would you go to a Helm chart and why would you have an operator?
All right. That's a great question that I was expecting as well from people. So Helm chart is, I would say, these two concepts are complementary. The operator pattern is a software design pattern that is that talks about actually coding the operational expertise you have, and the Helm chart is more like Homebrew for macOS. It's like a package manager for Kubernetes. It's going to help you install all those things. But if you were to actually push it to the limits, like a Helm chart was originally designed for just for the package management for the Kubernetes, but it has the capabilities to build an operator. You can actually just install an operator by using a Helm chart as well. So these concepts go hand in hand, rather than they are not a versus. Like it's not a showdown that you should do operators. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Thank you. Thank you for that talk, Gautam. I think you just demystified Kubernetes and operators for a lot of people, including me. So I think we should have a big round of applause for you. So let's do that.